Welcome back, students. Welcome to biology classes. Today we are going to see 10th science biology and we are going to resume chapter 9, that is heredity and evolution. We have already seen the introductory part as well as we have also seen about the two main topics, that is first is the monohybrid cross and second is dihybrid, that is the two experiments which were carried out by the Mendel. And yet today we are going to see the several different terms which are related to those topics. Okay, now today we are going to see about that how do the traits get expressed, that is how the characters are being expressed when we are talking about the genes from one generation to the next generation. Okay, so the cellular DNA is the information source for making proteins in the cell. So when we are talking about the characters which are being expressed, right? So the cellular DNA, that is the information source. So your DNA is having what? Every information for making the proteins in the cell, right? Now there is a part of DNA which is going to provide the information for one particular protein. So a small part of DNA is going to code for a protein and that is called a gene for that particular protein. So for every different protein, there will be like different genes which are present and they are going to code for different types of proteins. And the example of it can be given as the height of a plant depends upon the growth hormone, which is in turn controlled by the gene, right? So when we are talking about the example of it, then the height of the plant depends upon the growth hormone, that is how much amount of growth hormone is being released. So it is going to be controlled by the gene, and so that particular gene which is a part of DNA, that is going to do what? The expression of that particular character, right? So whatever expression is being carried out, that is with the help of the gene, and that is a small part of DNA. Now, if the gene is efficient and more growth hormone is secreted, the plant will grow tall. So, more if the gene is working efficiently, right? And if the more growth hormone is released, then the height of the plant will be tall. But if the gene for a particular protein, right, it gets altered. So when the alteration is taking place of that gene, and if the particular growth hormone is secreted less in amount, then the plant will be remaining short. So the plant will remain short in height. So this is the difference when the more growth hormone is released due to the efficiently working of gene, then the plant will be tall. And if the plant will be short, then what will be the scenario? That the gene is not working properly, that it is getting altered, and less amount of growth hormone is secreted, right? So now, so this is about that how the traits or the characters are being expressed. Now, both the parents contribute equally to the DNA of next generation during sexual reproduction. Now, when we are talking about the sexual reproduction, as you know that two of the parents, they contribute equally to generate the DNA of the next generation. So, half of the DNA is coming from the one parent and second half is coming from the second parent. So half and half, they combine with each other to form the exact equal DNA for the next generation. Now, they actually contribute a copy of the same gene, right? So how they are going to contribute for the same gene? Because both of them is going to contain what? The gene for from male as well as the female. That is, from both the parents, they are going to get the same genes. So when the example we can see is that when tall plant is crossed with short plants, the gametes will have single gene either for tallness or for shortness. So here when you are contributing a copy of the same gene, right? So at that time what happens that the genes will be present of both, right? But amongst these two of them, any one of them is going to be expressed. So just like in the monohybrid cross, we saw that when tall and short both are present in the F1 generation, but still the tall was comparatively dominant. For this reason, all the trees were tall in nature, right? So the F1 generation will get one gene for tallness, another for shortness. So even though there is presence of two different genes, but out of them, one is going to be recessive and the other one is going to be dominant. Next is, now how do the germ cells, that is the gametes, get single set of genes from parents who have two copies in them? Now, normally parents have two copies of the genes, right? But when we are talking about the next generation, right? So how the germ cells, that is the gametes, they get only single set of genes. Parents do have two copies of genes, but how the gametes have only single set of genes? So now we are going to see that. So each gene set is present not as a single long thread of DNA, but as separate independent pieces, which is known as chromosome. Now, normally each gene is not singly present, that it is not separated in your whole body, right? It is not a single thread of DNA also, right? But it is in the form of chromosome. So all the genes are being set into a medium, or we can say into the independent pieces into a chromosome, right? So each cell gets two copies of the chromosome, one from each parent, right? So the parent is going to have what? The chromosome, half of the mother, half of the parent. So half of the copy will be from the first parent and half will be from the second parent. So this way, two copies of the chromosome are being formed when we are talking for each cell, right? Now, each germ cell or each germ or cell or gamete has one copy of it, because there is reduction division in the sex organs at the time of formation of gametes, right? So when we are talking about the germ cell or a gamete, right, they have one copy of it. So they are going to have only one single copy. But when the reduction division is taking place, that is the meiosis is taking place in the sex organs, so at that time what happens? The gametes are formed. So diploid is not formed, but haploid is formed. For this reason, the meiosis is when taken is taking place at that time, half of the parent is only passing to the offspring, right? So when fertilization takes place, the normal number of chromosomes is restored in the progeny, ensuring the stability of DNA of the species. Now, when we are talking about the gametes, so gametes from male as well as female, so half will be present in the male gamete and half will be present in the female gamete. So when the fertilization is taking place at that time, these two of them combine with each other, and in this stage, the progeny, that is the daughter cells, they are going to have exact proper number of chromosomes, right? And this leads to the stability of the DNA of the species. So this way, the germ cells is going to have single set of genes, that is the gametes, right? But when we are talking about the daughter cells, they are going to have exact same gene set of just as the parents, right? Now we are going to see the next important topic, and that is sex determination, right? So as you know that sex determination, the word itself depicts that the determining of the sex of a newborn is known as sex determination, right? So it is the process by which sex of a newborn can be determined, whether it is a male or a female. That can be understood. Or if a person is going for the sex determination process, so that is it is not available now here. In abroad countries, this is legal. But when we are talking about India, this is crime, right? Now, different species use different strategies for this. Now, see, in mammals, it is different. In animals, it is, right? In animals, birds, and other species. So different types of species uses different strategies for sex determination, right? So in some animals, the temperature at which fertilized eggs are kept determines whether the developing animals will be males or females. So in few animals, what is the scenario? That in the temperature at which the eggs, like the fertilized eggs are kept. So at what temperature the eggs are being fertilized? So that can tell you whether the developing animal which is inside it is a male or female. So the oviparous animals, that is the animals which lay eggs, right? So in this type of animals, the temperature at which the fertilized eggs are kept at that time can be used to determine that whether it is a male or female. And some animals like snails can change sex, indicating that sex is not genetically determined. So like the example can be seen of snail, right? So the snails can change sex, that is from male to female or from female to male, right? So in them, it is not genetically determined whether whether the snail is a male or a female, right? Now, in human beings, the sex of the individual is determined genetically, means genes inherited from the parents decide the sex of the offspring. So when we are talking about the humans, male or female, that can be determined by the use of the genes which are being inherited from one generation to the next generation, that is from the parents to the offspring, right? So now we are going to see about the sex determination in human beings, right? So in human beings, all chromosomes are not paired, right? So all the chromosomes which are present in the human body, see, total 23 pairs of chromosomes are present, right? But not all the chromosomes are paired, right? 22 chromosomes are paired, right? And these 22 chromosomes, they are said to be autosomes, right? And only one single pair of chromosome is sex chromosome, right? And this sex chromosome is not paired, right? So 22 chromosomes are paired, but one pair is called sex chromosome and is odd in not having a perfect pair in males. In females, it is XX, but in males, it is XY. So it is same in the female, but when we are talking about the males, they are having XY. So you just need to remember that wherever the XX is there, that is depicting the female, and wherever XY is there, that is depicting the male, right? So on the other hand, males have a normal sized X, but the other is short, which is called Y. So in the females, they have perfect pair, and those both of them are XX and they are similar to each other. But when we are talking about the males, in males, what happened? X is of normal size, but the Y is comparatively a bit smaller than the X, right? And it is shown as the XY. Now, all the gametes or ova formed by the homozygous female are similar, that is, have X chromosome, right? Now, see, homozygous and heterozygous. Homo means same. So, as the female is having 2X, so both of the genes are same. For this reason, it is said to be a homozygous female. But in males, it is a male's heterozygous form. That is, as the male is hetero means different. So male is having X and Y, which are different from each other. For this reason, male is said to be heterozygous form. So female is said to be homozygous and male is said to be heterozygous. Now, how like the sex of the baby, it depends on fertilization, and there are two possibilities. So now we are going to see the two possibilities of the sex determination, which is observed in human beings, right? So this is the flow chart of the sex determination in human being, and this explains the whole procedure that how we can that which are the two possibilities of baby, right? So first, this is the male, which is having XY. This is the female, this is having XX, right? So the male gametes are sperms, the female gametes are ova, right? Now let's split this two of them. That is, these are the gametes, right? So X, you are separating X as well as you are separating Y. Here from this one X and the second X. So now we are having four gametes. Two from sperms and two from ovum, right? So this X and Y. Now, if this X binds with the X of the ovum, as shown in the figure, right, it forms XX. And here, this Y is when joined with this X, then it forms the XY. So wherever, if XX is forming, then it is going, then the baby girl is going to born. But when, if this Y is connecting, or if this Y is getting fertilized with this X, then this is going to form male. So there is 50% of chances, that 50-50% chances, right? So that 50% can be female and 50% can be male. So we cannot exactly determine that from the male side X is passing or Y is only passing, right? If X is passing, then it is female, and if Y is passing, then it will be male. So none another, the father is responsible for the deciding for the like the sex of the baby, right? So this is about the flowchart of the sex determination in human beings, right? Now, autosomes, right? See here, autosomes are those chromosomes which do not play any role in sex determination. So those autosomes does not play any role in the sex determination in humans. And the sex chromosomes are those chromosomes which play the role in determining the sex of the newborn. So this is the difference, main difference between autosomes and the sex chromosome. Autosomes does not play role in the sex determination, while the sex chromosome, they play the role in a sex determination process. So this is all about today's topic, that and this is one of the most important topic, and if you will be writing this flowchart, you will get proper marks. And this this figure or this flowchart explains the whole procedure of the sex determination in human beings. So I hope you are very clear with today's topic, and I hope to see you again. Thank you.